Lord God, we come this night to worship you. We worship you as we sing along with Gordon and Susan. We will worship you as Ishbel reads your word. We will worship you in the hearing of your word. Lord God, it is right that we come here this evening and offer you our praise. For you have been with us. You knitted us in our mother's womb. You numbered every hair on our heads. And you've promised that you will be with us always. And you, Lord, are a good God. You're always caring for us. You love us more than the best mother loves her child. When things are hard for us, we know that you feel the pain that we go through. When we laugh, we believe you laugh with us. And so how can we do anything but come tonight and worship you and offer again our lives to you? Lord God, you sent your Son, and he loved us so much that he was willing to go to the cross. And Lord God, we know that he takes our sins away. And so we bring to you now the hurt that we have caused others. We bring to you now those moments we wish we could have again. We acknowledge before you, Lord, that our thoughts about others are not always kind. Forgive us, Lord. Have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us and grant us your peace. And Lord God, we offer you now a familiar prayer, a prayer taught to us by Jesus Christ. And we ask that you hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
The first reading this evening is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 11. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and in which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of the first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter and then the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed. And the second reading is from Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 to 13. When Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him and asked for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home, paralyzed, suffering terribly. Jesus said to him, shall I come and heal him? The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one go, and he goes, and that one come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he was amazed, and said to those following him, truly, I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be a weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, let it be done just as you believed it would. And his servant was healed at that moment. Amen.
Be with me, Lord, as I share your word. And be with us all as we listen. Amen. Here's just a question that I'm going to ask you. If we all agree that the New Testament, the whole New Testament, is about Jesus, if I said to you exactly half the New Testament is about someone else, who would you say? Someone said it. I couldn't. Yeah, Paul. If we could argue that, there are 27 books in the New Testament. 13 of them are letters at least attributed to Paul. And then there's the Acts of the Apostles, of which half is about Paul. So 13.5 books out of 27 are about Paul. So I know some people this past week, last weekend, had the opportunity to go to the Keswick Convention, where Alistair Begg, a Scots-American preacher, was speaking about Paul. And I think it's fair to say, if you ask pretty much anyone what they think of Jesus. They would say that he was admirable, attractive, and appealing. I'm not sure it's the case if you asked everyone about Paul. Now, I was reading a French writer, Renan, who said that something that Paul wrote is the only thing in the New Testament as beautiful as the words of Jesus. It's the only thing that compares to the words of Jesus in terms of profound beauty. And that is, of course, his hymn to love in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not ill-tempered, love does not envy. It's beautiful. And that tells us something about Paul. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us how he can write in the most beautiful and profound way. But you only need to go on to the next chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, to understand some of the ways that the writing of Paul have caused pain to some people. So in 1 Corinthians 14, at verse 34, it says, "Let women be silent in church. They are not allowed to speak. There is something improper about a woman speaking in church." So that's just one example of something just in two chapters. 1 Corinthians 13, the beauty and profoundness of Paul. 1 Corinthians 14, words that have caused pain to some people. But we're not going to talk tonight about 1 Corinthians 13, 1 Corinthians 14. We're going to talk about 1 Corinthians 15. Because I think it says something of what is wonderful about Paul. Something about what he has given us. Now, I've been using, I don't know, do people ever use this translation? The J.B. Phillips translation of the New Testament. Yeah, some people are nodding. This is a translation of the Bible, J.B. Phillips, that came. J.B. Phillips spent times in the air raid shelters in the Second World War and was desperate to try and share the Bible with younger people. But he just felt they were utterly turned off by the language. And so he wrote a translation of the New Testament that's become a classic. The New Testament in Modern English, it's called. On the front, it says here, there's a quote from C.S. Lewis. "It's like looking at an old picture after it's been cleaned." It's like looking at an old picture after it's been cleaned. So I'm going to share from the J.B. Phillips translation of the Bible, but we'll keep going with the version here as well. Paul is writing here in verse 1. "Now I want to remind you the gospel that I have previously preached and which you have accepted. You've accepted it and on which you have taken your stand, and by which, if you remain faithful to the message I gave you, your salvation is being worked out. For what I have passed on to you is essential, and it's the message I have myself received." Now, just at this point, there's something I want to say about Paul that we could say technically half the New Testament is about him, but he's always pointing towards Jesus. He's always trying to point people towards Jesus. "For I passed on to you what is essential, the message I had myself received." Don't take it as from me. It's the message I had myself received. And these are what Paul considers the essentials, as we read from verse 3. "That Christ died for our sins, as the Scripture said he would," or here it says, "according to the Scriptures. That he was buried and rose again on the third day, again as the Scriptures foretold." Now, I'd be genuinely interested to know if you ever have a similar experience to me. Sometimes, and it doesn't happen all the time, but sometimes I feel God speaking to me clearly and making a promise to me. And of course I doubt it, I always doubt it. but it feels like God is making a promise to me. And it tends to be a promise about something that God knows otherwise I would just be worrying about. And here's the thing, I've only felt it about 5 times, such a clear thing. And yet every single time, the thing that I felt God promise has happened. And so it happened to me again, well, I know exactly when, it happened to me again 3 weeks and 2 days ago. And it was a hard day. It wasn't a fun day. And I was driving up Sutra, I think it is, if you know the hill with all the windmills. I don't know if it's on the A68 or the A72. A68. So if you know that hill, you go up to Sutra, and you're driving towards Edinburgh and Haddington and places like that, and then all of a sudden you get to the road divides and you get an overtaking lane as well. Do you know the way I mean? Now, partly my excuse is I've been living in Jersey, so I don't entirely know the highway code. But I assumed that when you have 2 carriageways like that, you can drive at 70. But you can't. So I was driving up Sutra on this hard day, and there was a truck in front, and got to the overtaking thing, and I thought, great, I'll pass it. And you know what happened? As soon as I turned out, there was a flash. And I thought, oh no. Life is just difficult today. The last thing I need is points on my license. I've never had them before. And I just thought, oh no. And here's the thing. I felt God say to me, you're not going to get a ticket. That's a promise. I'm not going to make you drive past this camera on this road you lose a lot and feel pain when you go past and you're reminded. I'm going to make you go past this camera and remember that God is with you. And of course, I doubt it. I always doubt it. And of course, every time the postman comes, I think, oh no. But I can tell you, and that's why I know it's 3 weeks and 2 days ago, that I think I can be pretty safe now that there isn't going to be a ticket coming. And I think there's something like that here with what Paul's saying here. He's telling us about the essentials, but do you see what he's saying? He's saying Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. It's as if he's saying, God promised us this. It's a reminder, God promised us this. It's us that doubt. God always promised this. And again, he says that he was buried, that he was raised again on the 3rd day, according to the scriptures. God promised this. God made this promise to us. It's us that doubt. God promised this. It's as if Paul is again saying that God made a promise to us. And all God's doing is fulfilling that promise. And he's reminding us again, we can trust God's word. And then it says that Jesus appeared to Cephas, or which being the Aramaic word for rock, in other words, to Peter the rock, then the 12, and then by over 500, the majority of whom are still alive, as Paul writes this. Then we come towards some of Paul's wonderful humbleness. He writes again that Jesus appeared after his resurrection to James, then all the messengers, and then even to me, Paul writes. I don't even deserve the title messenger because I persecuted the church. But I am what I am now because of the grace of God. And here is Paul saying something profound, something that he will say in other parts of his word that frankly change the church. Paul is saying that he is saved by grace alone. We know the story of Paul in the Bible. We know when the earliest Christians were in Jerusalem and began to spread the word that Paul was so strongly opposed to it. We know that he took personal responsibility for ensuring the extinction of Christianity. He was present at the stoning of Stephen. By the 9th chapter of Acts, he is persecuting those who are becoming Christians. And yet, famously we know, that on the road to Damascus, as he sets off to arrest some more Christians, he is blinded and sees the risen Jesus. And everything in that moment changes for Paul. You see, if Jesus is alive, then that changes everything for Paul. because Christ crucified now becomes the most important thing. If Jesus is no longer dead but alive, he must be then who he said he was. He must be the Son of God. Therefore, he must be the Christ. And what Paul realizes in that moment, on that road to Damascus, is that all the rules and regulations that he is rigorously defending are not central to being put right with God. Because God had burst into Paul's life, not because of his obedience to the law, but despite it. And for Paul, he was saved by grace. In other words, God totally accepts anyone who comes to him, regardless of their worthiness or unworthiness. No one needs to earn their right to be put right with God. Yeah, and this is the verse I really just want to finish with. There's 11 verses, but this is the verse I alluded to briefly this morning as well. But I want to finish by just talking about this verse. Paul writes, "By the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me." John Piper, who many of you may have read some of his books, John Piper writes that it's clear that living the Christian life the way Paul lived it is hard work. Living a Christian life can be hard, hard work. Paul believes that after what he had done to try and stop the spread of the good news of Jesus Christ, what had happened to him was he'd been gifted with a very great grace, as have those in Corinth with whom he is sharing now the essentials of the faith. But very great grace brings about very hard work. Now, the example John Piper uses is he speaks about it in his own church in America, that every Advent he writes poems for the church. And he writes about how every year these are such hard work to create. He writes about hitting brick walls again and again. He writes about these moments when he cries out, "Oh Lord, I need a breakthrough. Please help me." And what John Piper says he's learned is that after he has prayed about this, he should not just sit around with an empty mind, waiting for something to waken up his idling mind. It doesn't happen, John Piper says. God does not work that way. After praying, what John Piper does is he bends every fiber and effort to think and create. He works even harder after he's prayed for it. And then the breakthroughs come. And here's the thing, he says. When the breakthroughs come, they don't feel like miraculous grace. They instead feel agonizingly natural. But because John Piper has asked God for this grace, for this help, he gives God thanks. "It is not I, but the grace of God that was with me." And I see it in the writing of my own sermons. I see that when I follow every step right, when I properly, truly meditate on the passage I'm going to preach on, this sounds like a ridiculous thing to say, but I can't remember that when I've done this, I've ever preached a bad sermon. But I know there's plenty of times I take shortcuts. And sometimes the sermons are still okay, but I know plenty of bad sermons I've preached when I've taken those shortcuts. With very great grace comes about very hard work. And we see this also in the life of Paul. I don't know if anyone's ever seen pictures of Paul or paintings of Paul. But he's not what you might call an oil painting, according to what we understand of Paul's appearance. He wasn't a naturally attractive person to people. He says this in one of his letters. He says, I know people say about me, his letters are weighty and forceful, but in person he is unimpressive and his speaking amounts to nothing. That's what Paul acknowledges about himself. But after his very great grace, he sets about with hard work. He had to work hard to get the confidence in the disciples in Jerusalem after the horrendous things he'd done to their brothers and sisters. He had to work at traveling, even although he was probably ill his entire life. He had to rebound after rejections and accusations and worked hard, literally worked hard every day, to pay his own way, to remove barriers between him and those he was trying to reach with the good news of Jesus Christ. What is the same for writing Advent poems, John Piper says? What is the same for the life of Paul? It's the same for our lives as well. There's no biblical warrant to expect us to pray about things and just wait simply for God to answer our prayers. The biblical rule is I worked harder than all of them. This passage, or this conclusion to this extraordinary passage of Paul, helps us see, or helps us realize, that God has appointed good things to be hard work. We saw in the story of the faith of the centurion, read earlier from Matthew's gospel. The centurion didn't just pray for God's help to heal his servant, but went out of his way, despite all the social barriers, to go and to find Jesus. Think of Philippians 2, verses 12 and 13. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Or 2 Timothy 2:15, be diligent. A workman does not need to be ashamed. It's not the same as saying that those of us here who are exhausted from the week, who know we should probably work less, it's not the same as saying you just need to work harder. I think the insight here is that prayer is not a replacement for hard work. Prayer is the atmosphere for work. It is what gives our work its supernatural effectiveness. When we pray about something, breakthroughs come, not immediately, and often not without an awful lot of hard work. You know the things that you will pray about this evening. You know the things that you worry about. The things that you want to happen. You know the things that you just feel you can't sort without God's help. And what Paul seems to be helping us to understand is that alongside our prayers, we can't just sit back and wait for God to solve our problems. We need to keep working hard at solving them. So when we leave here, when we go back to our lives outside, remember that beauty and truth do not always come by mystical revelations and inspirations. Beauty and truth will sometimes come by painstaking effort and trial and prayer and self-correcting. Paul says, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Amen. So we know there's someone in our church who's going in for an operation on this week, so we'll pray for them. We'll pray, if that's okay, for the what's going to happen when news may come about the manse at Trinity and who may be there. And then there'll be a time in the prayers for you just to offer your own prayers. And don't worry about dressing up the language. Just speak to your God, who loves you so much. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for all we can learn about Paul. Thank you that you changed his heart. That you used that miry clay. Thank you, Lord, the power you have to change things. To turn things towards good. We thank you, God, for Paul and the saints that have gone before us. And all that we can learn about you through them. Lord God, that centurion had faith. Just believed that Jesus Christ could heal. That Jesus Christ would answer prayers. Help us to have that belief, Lord, as we offer our prayers this evening. Lord God, we pray for decisions being made about people who may or may not move into the Trinity manse. We pray that if people come into that manse, that we may be good neighbors to them. We pray that they can settle in. We pray for their physical neighbors, that they may get on well. And we pray for Irene and Sheila and Ellen as they lead us in this work. We pray for the member of our church who is going into hospital this week for an operation. Look after them, God. Keep them safe, please. We pray for those we know who have received good news this week. Thank you, Lord, that you have watched over them. You have been with them and their loved ones in the weeks of worry. And you're with them in the happiness. Lord God, we know that life will not always be easy. We know that many of us will face struggles in the week ahead. But even in the struggles, help us not to lose sight of what is important. Help us to find opportunities to love our neighbor, to serve our God. And now, in a moment of quiet, we offer you, Lord, our own prayers. So, Lord God, as we continue to offer our prayers to you, help us leave this place with a peace, with a trust that you have heard these prayers. Help us, Lord, to rest, knowing that these prayers are with you. And help us to be people who can live and work knowing of your amazing grace. Amen. May God go with us as we leave this place. May God be with us in our home. May God be with us in the week ahead. And until we meet again, help us all to know the blessing of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.